Ladies and gentlemen, Liam Neeson.
Good evening. I had the good fortune to work with Stephen on Schindler's List. That was a time when, as never before, as he related later, it was on Schindler's List that he became fully aware of the profound power of the cinematic image on an audience. Dedicated to telling this terrifying story of the Holocaust and redemption, he shared with all of us on set his vulnerability, his fear at the magnitude of this task, and we adored him for it. His honesty inspired all us actors to share our fear and vulnerability. And like the leader he is, his passionate certainty for how he wanted to tell this story allowed us to follow him into emotional places we might not have had the courage to go. He pushed us hard, with an urgency to make his vision a reality. The more we worked on the film, the more I understood I was a member of a really great team. And yes, I was being used by a great director, the same way John Ford used James Stewart, John Wayne, and Henry Fonda. Stephen, I recall a story President Abraham Lincoln told about a man who was tarred, feathered, and run out of town. Asked later what he thought of the experience, the man replied, "If it weren't for the honor of the thing, I would rather have walked." To you, Stephen, man of passion, humanity, vision, and greatness, walk, don't run through this moment. The honor of the thing is richly deserved.
Phoenix, Arizona. "The best thing my parents gave me," he said, "was permission to let my imagination run." For his merit badge in photography, he borrowed his dad's movie camera and started making movies about the family's camping trips. The first actress he directed was his mother. No boy loved his toy chest more. "When I finished one film," he said, "my appetite got a little bigger, and the next day I started again. There were so many stories to tell." One summer, he visited Universal Studios, hopped off the tourist tram, and stayed a few weeks. After hours, he talked films with the studio librarian. He sent the librarian his next film. When the head of Universal saw it, he offered Stephen a 7-year contract. His first chance at the big screen ended with a disappointment at the box office. When he started on a seaside adventure, he didn't know if he'd even finish the film. It started sinking like a leaky boat. The budget doubled, and the main character just wouldn't bite. A national craze, a new kind of blockbuster. He was 29, and the country was about to take a joyous ride.
Thank you.
his youth, the artist expresses his own fears and joys. In manhood, he takes on the world and stories that face the heart of darkness. I threw out my toolbox, he said, and started from scratch.
These are mine. These are my workers. They should be on my train. They're skilled munitions workers. They're essential. Essential, girls. Their fingers polish the insides of shell metal casings. How else am I to polish the inside of a 45 millimeter shell casing? You tell me. You tell me.
Back on the train! Back on the train!
I made Saving Private Ryan, he said, for all the ordinary soldiers of World War II. His stories have become the memories of us all. Asked his favorite ending, he replied, hope.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tom Hanks.
A few decades ago, a young man showed up at the gates of fabled Universal Studios, dressed in a very cheap suit, carrying an empty prop of a briefcase, hoping to sneak into one of Hollywood's great temples of magic making. Though he had yet to do so professionally, he was already a filmmaker, and one of some repute, in fact. His cinematic talents had been highlighted by the entertainment media's voracious appetite for scoops as early as May 1st, 1963, when the Scottsdale Progress broadsheeted the headline, "Boy 16 makes his own movies." His casts were made up of his parents, Arnold and Lee, his sisters, and his buddies. For as he stated himself on the record, we don't have stars in our movies. One day, he snuck onto the stage where Alfred Hitchcock was directing Torn Curtain to see what the master of suspense do what he wanted to do himself. It was Hitchcock and Spielberg together for the first and only time. Right up until the moment he was thrown off the set by Alfred Hitchcock. As members of the audience, we are all grateful to have witnessed the artistic promise of film through your film, Stephen. And as a member of the acting community, I am grateful you wised up and started putting stars in your movies. Now, tonight, some people have come here to Washington from different parts of the country to pay special tribute to Stephen.
Great World War II heroes who fought their way ashore on D-Day in 1944.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leonard Lomel. Many years ago, I served as the First Sergeant of Company D, 2nd Ranger Battalion, United States Army in World War II.
Thomas Blakey, 505 Parachute Infantry Regiment, 82nd Airborne Division.
I am Charles Edward McGee, 302nd Fighter Squadron, 332nd Fighter Group.
I'm Walter D. Ehlers, 18th Infantry Regiment, 1st Infantry Division, the Big Red One.
I'm Hal Baumgarten of the Company B, 116th Infantry Regiment, 29th Division. Stephen, I'm the guy who had a lot of chutzpah to paint a Star of David on my Army field jacket, which I used when I landed with the first wave on Dahl Green Sector of Omaha Beach, which you portrayed in Saving Private Ryan. Now all of us, are here this evening to thank you for putting our story on film for future generations to remember. And thank you, Stephen, for telling it exactly as it happened.
These heroes, and others like them, fought their way through France and Germany, bringing an end to the war in Europe and liberating the concentration camps. Among the many who were liberated was a 20-year-old girl from Czechoslovakia. She is here with us tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Renee Firestone.
Those of us who survived the Holocaust were worried that soon our stories will be forgotten. But after Schindler's List, a miracle happened. You, Stephen, created the Shoah Foundation and recorded tens of thousands of survivors' testimonies. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you for what you have done for all of us. And of course, what you have done for history. You are our hero. Thank you, Stephen.
Ladies and gentlemen, 2004 Kennedy Center honoree, John Williams.
Thank you very much. Stephen, sharing our 34-year collaboration has been a great privilege for me. And it's been an inspiration to watch you dream your dreams and nurture them and make them grow. And in the process, entertain and edify billions of people around the world. So tonight, we would like to salute you musically with a piece, I think, that expresses this spirit so beautifully. It was written by Leonard Bernstein, a 1980 Kennedy Center honoree, who was, incidentally, the first composer ever to be performed in this hall. Here is the finale to Bernstein's opera Candide, Make Our Garden Grow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Carolyn Blackwell and Gregory Touré, joined by the United States Army Chorus and the Choral Arts Society.
Let dreamers dream what worlds they please. Those hiddens can't be found. So let us try before we die to make some sense of life. We're neither pure nor wise nor good. We'll do the best.
We know. Yeah.